Praise the Lord, hallelujah. It's something to be able to bless that wonderful name. No other name. No other name that I know. Praise the Lord, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. It's good to be able to praise the Lord. As we come now to opening up the secrets of God's scriptures, we ask those of you that have a Bible and venture to turn with us today that you would turn to the Gospel according to Luke. The Gospel according to Luke, the 20th chapter. Our curriculum will start at verse number 19. We do ask those of you that are able that you would please stand for the reading of our story and not just word. Luke chapter 20, starting at verse 19, there you will find these words written by the physician, and it says, "And the chief priests and the scribes the same hour sought to lay hands on him. And they feared the people, for they perceived that he had spoken this parable against them. And they watched him and sent for spies, which should feign themselves just men, that they may take hold of his words, so they might deliver him unto the power and authority of the governor. And they asked him, saying, Master, we know that thou sayest and teachest rightly, neither accepteth thou the person of any, but teacheth the way of God truly. Is it lawful for us to give tribute unto Caesar, or no? But he perceived their craftiness, and said unto them, Why tempt ye me? Show me the money. Whose image and subscription have it? They answered and said, Caesar's. And he said unto them, Render therefore unto Caesar the things which be Caesar's, and unto God the things which be God's. And they could not take hold of his words before the people, and they marveled at his answer, and held their peace." God's word for God's people. It is blessed and may that a blessing to us all. Eternal God, our Father, again, Lord, we do thank you. Thank you, Father God. We thank you, Father God, for just allowing us to come into your presence and worship you in spirit as well as in truth. And we just pray, Father God, now that you will just speak to us and speak to us, Lord, in such a way that we know that we have heard from you. And Father God, we pray as always that you will just send a word, Father God, that satisfies all of our needs. And then, Lord, your manservant, as always, I pray that you would hide me behind the cross that only you might be seen. I pray, Lord, that you would speak to my mind and speak through these lips of clay that I might give your word if you have given it unto me. And then, as always, Father God, I ask for preaching power, the kind of power that makes preaching easy. Lord, I ask all these things in your Son, Jesus Christ, and our Lord, you say in his holy and his precious name. And let the church say, amen. 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 For the moments that we have to share today, church, I come with a word that says, it's decision time. It's decision time. Irregardless of your race, whether you're black, white, Indian, Latino, or Asian, you know what time it is. Yes. Regardless of your party affiliation, whether you're Democrat, Republican, independent, or simply lost, you know what time it is. Regardless of where you're from, where you're going, how you live, or where you live, you know too what time it is. Because unless you've been living on Mars somewhere, and unless you haven't looked at the news, unless you haven't opened up the internet lately, you too know what time it is. Yes, yes. Something tells me that all of us in here know that here in America, it's decision time. You see, because in just 2 days now, citizens all over this country will be going to the polls in order to cast their ballots. And this may not be the year, church, in which we elect a president, but I do believe this is one of the most important elections of our lifetime. You see, because of the choices that we make on Tuesday, they will not only define who will lead us and represent us, but these choices on Tuesday, I believe they will say a whole lot about us. On Tuesday, we'll get to tell the world who we are and who we want to be. On Tuesday, we'll get to say, as Americans, exactly what we stand for. In church, I'm no politician, so I'm not going to stand up here and try to tell you who the candidates are, what the issues are, or who to vote for. Because the truth of the matter is, all of us know who the candidates are. All of us know what they've done and what they said. And all of us know who and what they stand for. And so in just a few days, all of us will have the opportunity of a lifetime. Because all of us will have our chance to cast our ballots and vote. And so what I want to encourage somebody in here is, do not stay home on Tuesday. All right. Because somebody told you that your vote doesn't matter. Because somebody here knows that the devil is a liar. Because your vote does matter and your vote will be counted. They're doing all they can not to count these ballots on Tuesday. But you got to make up in your mind that they may not count it, but I'm going to cast it. All right. Time out for people staying at home saying it ain't gonna matter. They gonna do what they wanna do anyway. That's the person that comes to the meeting, y'all, and raises all kind of sand. And then when it's time to vote, they decide to abstain. All right. Like they really doing something. And then they wanna know after you counted the yeas and the nays if you're gonna count the abstentions. And you tell them, that's your vote already been counted when you decided not to raise your hand. Because you voted with the affirmative. All right. Same thing, if you don't vote on Tuesday, whoever wins Tuesday night, then you ought to tell somebody on Wednesday morning, that's who I voted for. All right. If you don't vote, you voting for the winner. If you don't want to be with the losers, you can always go vote. And then on Wednesday, they say, that was my candidate all along. They got my vote. See, the great thing, church, about decision time is every person gets to make up their own mind. Every person gets to decide for themselves who they're going to vote for, because I've always heard it said that we might be the same color, but that don't mean we're the same kind. All right. That don't mean that, church, we got to vote for the same person. And in the same way I can't choose who you're going to vote for, I cannot choose who you're going to serve. That's why my Bible tells me that when Joshua got ready to speak to the children of Israel for the very last time, the Bible said that Joshua took them to the valley of Shechem. And Joshua told them there that it's decision time. You are going to have to choose this day who you're going to serve. And Joshua told them, either you're going to serve the gods of your fathers or serve the gods of the Amorites in whose land you now dwell. But Joshua said, look, I've already made a decision. I've already made my choice. And I've already made up my mind. And he said, I'm so glad that I can say that. That's for me and my house. Joshua said, we're going to choose to serve the Lord. And so again, church, I can't tell you who to vote for. And even if I could, I wouldn't try to tell somebody who they are to give their support to. But I can't tell you how to make up your mind. But what I can tell you is, whatever you decide to do on Tuesday, you better make sure that you said yes to the Lord. You better make sure that you're on the Lord's side. Because let me tell you, I found out a long time ago that as long as you're on the Lord's side, it really doesn't matter who's in the White House, who's in control of Congress, or who's sitting on the Supreme Court. Because I'm the one who called the Lord and King of Kings, and I'm the one who got all power in his hands. God told me a long time ago that as long as I keep my hands in his hands, then everything is going to be all right. So, church, as we turn our attention to this text, I know somebody may be saying, but what in the world does this text have to do with decision time? Well, I'm glad you asked, because here we see the enemies of Jesus trying to trap him. But the thing that they did not realize, church, is they couldn't trap him, tempt him, or trump him, because this is God in the flesh. See, what they did not understand is that he was omniscient, which means that he knew their every move and them in every thought before they ever made it. And Jesus knew when he heard them speaking that they were nothing more than sheep and wolves in sheep clothing. And all they were doing, church, was pretending to love him, pretending to be holy. Why? For their own purposes. And again, that'll be a word for somebody in here. Because the truth of the matter is, everybody that's sitting in church, everybody that's singing songs, everybody preaching sermons, truly do not love the Lord. Because again, some of us are just acting the part and just looking like they're holy. And that's why when decision time comes, you got to do more than just listen, church. But you got to watch some stuff. You got to do more than just try to discern what people are doing. But sooner or later, you got to watch what they already done. Because anybody can act the part. Anybody can tell you a good story. But again, but when it's decision time, how many of us are going to be truly willing to say, to stand up and say, for the Lord I stand, for God I live, and for God I die. Because that's what it's all about. The most important decision we're going to make is not the one we're going to make on Tuesday, but it's the one that we're going to make for Jesus Christ. And so here Jesus gives all of us a prescription for some things that you got to do when it's time to make your decision. If you haven't already done it, you still got some time. And the first thing that Jesus teaches us before you make your decision is you have to recognize their motives. You see, the Bible tells us that Jesus had just delivered a parable about the vineyard. When his enemies heard it, they assumed. Some of y'all know what you do when you assume, right? I'm not going to say it, but some of y'all know. They assumed that Jesus was talking about them. And this time, if I had time, church, I'd put a pin and hang out right there for a while. Because far too often, this is exactly what church folks do. Church folks sometimes hear only what they want to hear. You can talk for an hour and they heard two words. And the only two words they know is all they talk about. And when they do that, they make the wrong assumptions and they jump to the wrong conclusions. And their first instinct when people do this, hearing them, if they think the preacher mad or the preacher talking about them. Some think that they're so important. And all week long, while the preacher was preparing his sermon, while he was up and studying, he had me on his mind. Hallelujah, somebody. I must really be important for that man to be thinking about me all night long. Bible said that he supposed to be church folks. After they heard the preaching and teaching of Jesus, that they just weren't mad. But instead, they wondered how they might lay hands on him. Church, something tells me that they weren't trying to lay hands on him so that they could anoint him with oil. Right. And instead of doing what the Bible says, this is for somebody right here. Here's how the Bible says you ought to deal with somebody that done you wrong. The Bible says in Matthew 18:15 that if your brother or sister sins against you, you ought to go to them, point out their fault. Why? Between the two of you.
That's right. Amen.
Say that again. The Bible says that if your brother or your sister has offended you, it says if you are a Christian, you don't have to call Deacon Curry. You don't have to call your family deacon. You don't have to send a mass text message. It says, go to that person. And the two of y'all work it out in Christian love. That's for somebody right there. You ain't got to go through all that. The Bible said that if you are a believer in Jesus Christ, if you can't work it out in Christian love, you might ask yourself, are you really a believer? Because again, instead of going to Jesus, look at what these church folks did. The Bible said that they came up with a plan to how they could get Jesus to fall. Then they said, you know, since we can't get him to fall, since we can't defeat him on our own, they said, here's what we're going to do. We're going to go get somebody to pretend to love him. We're going to get some folks to act like they on his side. And that's why, again, church, you got to be careful of who you let get close to you. before you know what they're up to and where they're coming from. I tell people all the time, you can't let everybody get that close to you where they can lay hands on you and they can know what's going on in your house.
All right.
You know the old saying, the old folks say, some people got a level with a long handle spoon. Because there's some folks you can't let get close to you because they'll put all your business in the streets. You'll be wondering how everybody know your business, and it's because your best friend telling all your business. Because again, I learned a long time ago that everybody is trying to lay hands on you and trying to do it for your good. And everybody that's smiling in your face and saying they love you really do not love you. That's why I've come to let you know, church, that if the devil cannot get you to fall on his own, what the devil will do is he will find somebody to send your way with the only purpose to make you fall. And what the devil will do is he'll get somebody that looks the part or acts the part. But the truth of the matter is their only purpose is to rob, kill, and to destroy you. That's why, church, you got to be careful of your own desires.
Yeah.
And you got to be careful of other people's
motives. That's right.
Some of y'all know that I'm on Facebook and every now and then, but I don't send out too much stuff. But I got a message this week. I don't know who this person was, but first they sent me a scripture text. Then they sent me a prayer. I had to look at somebody.
All right.
But then they sent me a friend request.
All right.
I know this person. The next day, you know what I got? I'm 34, single, no kids. Can I get to know you better?
All right.
I'm all ready up, so I hand the phone to my wife and said, see him? I want you to know what she up to. Because if you think people care about you, a preacher, are you saved, are you married, folks don't care about that. Folks are up to no good. And it's your fault if you don't check in your desires and other people's
goals.
All right. Sometimes you gotta ask folks, like Jesus said, why are you trying to tell me?
Why?
Are they up to something? Sometimes you got to ask people questions when they come to you. When people come to you talking about Pastor Singleton, you ought to ask them, have you gone to him? If they say no, well, why are you bringing this to me? Because they up to something. If you ain't man or woman enough to talk to him, then I need to know why are you talking. Because I'm here to tell you what they're up to. They're up to no good. They're up to no good. And the same thing with some of these candidates on Tuesday. You got to ask yourself, why are they running these commercials? You know, because some of the stuff they say, they're saying it without saying it. When they tell you that they are a bona fide conservative, they're trying to tell you something. They're up to something. When they're trying to give you their vote record, they up to something. When they come to your church when it's voting season, and you ain't seen them before, you ain't gonna see them again, they up to something. And you gotta ask yourself, why are you showing up there? I ain't seen you last year, I ain't seen you in the spring, why I seen you now? Why are you having a town hall meeting now? Why are you that knocking on the door now? I'm here to tell you. They up to something. And if you don't try to find out what they're up to, you might fall just like this.
All right.
See, because my Bible said, how can two walk together?
Unless
they agree.
Yeah.
The second thing that Jesus teaches us is not only do you got to recognize their motive, Jesus said you got to resist their words.
Yeah.
Because again, church, if you don't know anything else about these Pharisees, you got to know this. They know how to lay it on thick. Notice in the text how to compliment Jesus. Notice how to talk about him. If you didn't know it, you would have thought they were true believers.
Yeah.
They said, now Jesus, we know that thou sayest and teachest right. Jesus, we know that you will accept the word of any person. We know that you only teaches the ways of God. You are holy man. Again,
Here's what you got to learn about Jesus. Jesus didn't allow him to fall. He didn't even allow him to stroke his ego. You see, because Jesus already knew who he was.
Yeah.
And so he didn't allow that opinion of him to become his opinion of himself. And again, that's a word for somebody. Sometimes you got to accept what people say, but you got to let it roll off your back. You can't hold on to it. Because if people know they can lift you up, here's what they also know. They can tear you down. That's why you can't depend on people's words to get you happy.
Yeah.
You gotta have something on the inside called Jesus Christ that gets you happy all by yourself. Yeah. See, the reason Jesus didn't let the words get to him was because the Bible says he could perceive their craftiness. That's what Jesus said. And Jesus said, now why are y'all trying to tempt me? Again, church, some of y'all know this. Some of y'all know these politicians are they crafty.
All right.
They can say a whole lot of stuff and don't say nothing.
That's right.
They can answer a whole lot of questions and don't answer nothing. And that's why you gotta listen carefully, not just to what they say. But you gotta listen carefully to what they're not saying.
Uh-huh.
That's why I like that brother down in Florida that's running for governor. I sure wish I was in Florida just so I could cast my vote for him. I'm a little Floridian, but I sure like what he said, you know, because his candidate is getting money from racist cause.
Yeah,
the client, all these folks paying for him. He told him, if you don't want their support, give them back their money. And he said, no, I ain't gonna give them money because their money's still stealing.
All right.
And so here the brother school was school. He said, look, I ain't saying that you're racist. But here's what I'm gonna say. The folks that are racist,
right,
they think you're racist.
Right.
Amen. Because sometimes they say a whole lot without really saying something. Because they're sending signals, they're sending dog whistles at the folks they're trying to attach. That's why you can't let them fool you of what they're saying, and don't be confused about the truth. Because the truth can get wishy-washy.
Yeah.
Excuse me, the truth can sometimes get a little funny, yeah, during election time. Folks' memories get a little short during election time. And that's why folks start saying stuff that they know ain't true, but it sure sounds good. Sure looks good on a t-shirt or a banner. That's why my grandma used to tell me this one thing. She always told me, she said, let me tell you something, boy, be careful of people.
Uh-huh.
That in order to lift themselves up, they got to tear somebody up.
Uh-huh. Right.
So always be careful of those kind of people, because she said, if you're doing right and living right, you ain't got to talk about other folks.
Right.
If your light's shining the way it ought to be shining, then you ain't got time to worry about somebody else like being
here. Yes.
She said, you got to be careful of folks. Because again, my Bible said, only he who is without sin,
yes,
or cast the stone. And since all of us have sinned, all of us have missed the mark, and all of us have fallen short of the glory of God, none of us ought to have a rock in our hand.
All right.
Instead of using our words to tear people down, we ought to be using our words to lift them up and build them up and point them toward Jesus. But Jesus said, what you've done under the least of these, you also done it unto me.
Yes.
So you got to be careful of all this negative advertising.
Yes, yes.
You got to be careful of folks that ain't got nothing good to say about nobody, mm-hmm, other than themselves.
Yes.
There's some folks out there that ain't got nothing good to say about nobody but themselves. And you got to be careful. You got to ask yourself, why are you doing that? But lastly, Jesus said, now before you make your decisions, he said you have to render your tributes. Yes? You got to render your own tributes in the right place. Because see, after all this Jesus was talking to him about, he finally gets down now to the crux of the matter. Jesus knew that there was a reason these hypocrites came to him in the first place. And he knew that all their words, all their actions, because they wanted to ask Jesus. Because they wanted him to give the wrong response.
Yeah.
Because they knew that if he gave the wrong response, they could immediately have him arrested. They could have him brought up on charges. You see, but again, what they failed to realize was Jesus knew what they were up to. So when they asked the question, they said, Jesus, here's what we need to know. Is it lawful to pay tribute unto Caesar? Now see, they knew the scriptures.
Yeah.
That you should have no other God before him.
Right.
All honor, all praise, and all glory belongs to God. They knew the scriptures. They knew it well. They knew the Psalms. They recited them every day. So they asked Jesus, well, is it lawful for us, Jews, to give tribute to Caesar? And again, they were hoping that Jesus was going to say no. They were hoping that he was going to say, all honor and glory belongs to me. Because if he had said that, he would have been arrested for not recognizing Caesar as the one and only king in Rome. Again, Jesus knew what they were up to instead of giving them a direct answer. Jesus knew what Jesus said, just show me the money. just, you know, sometimes if you got to tell folks, just show me the money. Because the money will tell you everything. Just, don't tell me your voting record, just show me the money. Don't tell me where you stand, just show me where the money coming from. You know, that's why we can't have gun laws. Because the money. The folks, the NRA, that's sending all this money, they can turn off the pipeline. Just show me the money. But that's a whole other story. Jesus said, just show me the money. And Jesus didn't ask the question. He said, now is this Caesar's face on this money? And they said, yes, it is. He said, well, listen, I tell you what. Then you render unto Caesar the things that are Caesar. But at the same time, render unto God the things that are God. That's a word for somebody. Some folks think that as long as they're giving money to the church, that's what God really wants from them. As long as they're paying tithes and offering, that God is happy and they've done everything they're supposed to do.
All right.
But that ain't what God is asking for, because God don't need our money.
That's right.
My Bible says that my Father not only owns the cattle on a thousand hills, but he owns the hills. And so God ain't interested in your money. God, church ain't surviving because of your giving. God says, I am the one. What Jesus was really saying in church, in case you don't understand it, was Jesus was saying, listen, don't give credit where credit is not deserved. In other words, he said, Caesar had done some stuff. But there's some stuff Caesar didn't do. Caesar got limited power. But Caesar ain't got all power. And again, somebody needs to hear that right now. Because there's already some pundits out there trying to tell us as black folks that we're going to be in trouble and we need to be scared if this blue wave turns red on Tuesday night.
All right.
That's what they're trying to tell us. We need to be scared. We need to run and hide, because if he get the Supreme Court, the White House, the Senate, and the House of Representatives, old Trump is going to have all of them. He can do whatever he want to do. Ain't nobody going to be able to stop him. What the devil is about. There's some things he ain't going to be able to do. There's some power he'll never have. I don't care what happens on Tuesday. He ain't going to have all power in his hands. That's why all I can tell you is, you can believe what you want to believe. You can bow down to who you want to bow down to, and you can worship who you want to worship. But the God I serve is sitting on the throne right now, and no matter what happens on Tuesday, no matter who wins the election, he's going to be sitting on the throne come Wednesday morning. He told me to remind somebody that real power is not in the hands of the president. It's not in the hands of Congress, and it's not in the hands of the Supreme Court. And if you want to know where real power is, then all you got to do is say the Lord's Prayer. Because it ends by saying that thine is the kingdom and thine is the power forever and ever. Amen. Let me when we say that, that's God's way of reminding us that I had the power all the way back in the beginning. I had the power when the children of Israel were trapped at the Red Sea. I had the power all through history. I had the power when your ancestors were enslaved. He said, I had the power then, and I got the power now, and I shall have the power in the future. So I said, I've got the power. Again, all of us need to hear that. Because God is trying to tell somebody in here, look, I got a blessing with your name on it. And the good news for you, God got a blessing with your name on it. It ain't dependent on the election or the economy. It ain't dependent on your education or your background. It ain't controlled by Caesar or the president. Because the Bible says that every good and perfect gift comes directly from God. Reason the Bible tells us that is because the Bible lets us know that up there in heaven, God has a window. And when God gets ready to bless you, he don't ask somebody else about what you've been doing. He don't ask somebody else, do you deserve a blessing? All God does is open up his window, and God starts pouring out his blessing on whoever he chooses. And that's why, church, that's why all our honor, all our praise, all of our glory belongs to God. That's why we don't say anything else. We ought to be able to say that he's great and greatly to be praised. Why? That's when you ought to get happy if somebody asks you, why do you give God so much praise? You ought to say, man, I'm so glad God is here. I praise him because I know that it came down through 40 years, your generation. I praise him because I know that it went to that old rugged cross. I praise him because I know that it went down into that borrowed tomb. But I really give him praise because I know that early that Sunday morning, he got up with all power in his hands. Maybe God let somebody know that, look, I made my decision. Now it's time for you to make your decision. Because it's decision time. And I ain't talking about Tuesday morning at the polls. I'm talking about right up here in Martin Street Baptist Church. It's decision time. As Joshua said, we all got to choose you this day. Who you going to serve? You can choose to serve the folks up in Washington, D.C. You can choose to serve the folks down the street in the state capitol. Or you can choose to serve the Lord.
Yes. Amen.
Who's been better to us than we've been to ourselves. Come on, let us bless the Lord.